I'd like to welcome everybody to this presentation this evening. I am Doreen Hindman. I am the Executive FC Administrator for Sashbear, the Sashbear Foundation in Canada. And our mission is to disseminate life-transforming skills based on dialectical behavior therapy to help those with emotion dysregulation and to help their families and all of the people who surround them and to advocate for better support and treatment in these situations. We are very happy to have with us this evening Dr. Karyn Hall to present on radically open dialectical behavior therapy, which will be very relevant to many of you, I'm sure. Before we get started, just a few housekeeping notes. I want to remind you that the Sashbear Foundation is a charitable organization, and we operate on a lot of volunteer effort and a lot of donations from individuals who have benefited from our services. So if you feel inclined to support us financially, we accept donations through Canada Helps. I also just want to let you know that this is a webinar, which means that you are all automatically muted and your cameras are not visible to us. So that means that your dog can bark in the background, you can finish your dinner or sip your tea and not worry about any distractions bothering the rest of us. You're quite welcome to post questions. Dr. Hall will be able to answer a few questions at the end, and we will moderate those questions and ask her the ones of the most general interest. So we would ask that you put your questions into the Q&A section. You can also use the chat, and those questions will be directed to Kathleen and myself. So I just also want to mention that I'm joined today by Kathleen, who is one of our volunteers. And I also want to shout out because she's also using some of her time off this week to volunteer to help us out at the organization. So it's really, really nice that she's here with us again tonight after having helped me all day as well. So now I will move on to introduce Dr. Hall. Dr. Hall is the director and the founder of two organizations, the Dialectical Behavior Therapies Center and DBTWise. Both of them are in Houston, Texas. DBTWise is a training company for psychotherapists, and she is the second radically open dialectical behavior therapy supervisor to be credentialed in the United States. And she is certified by the DBT-Linehan Board of Certification in DBT, which is the gold standard. She's also a writer, and Dr. Hall blogs for Psychology Today. She is the author of Mindfulness Exercises for DBT Therapists, Savvy, and The Emotionally Sensitive Person. She is the co-author of The Power of Validation and a co-author of the forthcoming The Radically Open DBT Workbook for Eating Disorders from Overcontrol and Loneliness to Recovery and Connection, which is expected to be published in May of this year, 2022. She is also currently working on a Radically Open DBT family program and manual. In addition to all of this, she is also a friend of Sashbear for many years. Sashbear has collaborated with Dr. Hall on many occasions in the past. For example, Lynn Curry, our founder and president, joined with Dr. Perry Hoffman and Dr. Hall on presentations at international conferences in Cuba and in Vienna. Sashbear is honored to have her support the work we do, and we are so very pleased to have her with us tonight. So with that, I will turn it over to you, Karyn.
So good evening, everyone, and welcome. COVID has me working from home. So speaking of dogs, I have two, Atlas and Plato. So they are usually pretty good, but you may hear from them tonight. So I ask for your grace in putting up with my dogs if they decide to let their presence be known. Okay, so let's talk about radically open dialectical behavior therapy. It's a very exciting new therapy that has been developed by Dr. Thomas Lynch, and I have some ideas that I really want to share with you. By the way, radically open dialectical behavior therapy has a component of fun and playfulness and silliness in it. So in the presentation, in keeping with the principles of RO DBT, we'll have some fun too, and a little bit of silliness. So be prepared. So this part is not so fun. In mental health, as you probably are aware, we are just beginning to be able to evaluate our treatments and to really find out what makes treatments work for which person, and how do we choose the right treatment for the right individual to have the most impact. People are exhausted often by going to different therapies and trying to find the help that they need and really developing some hopelessness from this treatment didn't work, this one didn't. And clinicians keep saying, but try this one. We need to do better. And what we have right now is that existing treatments often aren't effective with chronic depression and anorexia nervosa, for example. In the case of depression, treatments consistently help only 1/3 of the individuals. Another 1/3 improve, but they stay symptomatic, and that 1/3 don't improve at all. That's not good enough. We are not doing well enough. And the research needs to help us help more people consistently and to be able to match the treatment with the individual. A significant proportion of people fail to benefit from treatment because we know some of the reasons. Chronicity, the disorder has been ongoing for a long time and has affected the development of the person and their personality. Comorbidity, because there are a lot of people, and I'm guessing you've had that experience, have multiple diagnoses. So which therapy is going to treat which diagnosis? And then pre-existing personality problems, which still, although the DBT has done a great job at helping clinicians begin to identify the under-control personality, borderline personality disorder, we still aren't paying enough attention to other underlying personality disorders and how that affects the treatment that we're offering. And it's a serious problem. 1 out of 10 people in the community, the research shows, has a personality disorder. And you know what? Overcontrolled is the most common, a personality disorder based on overcontrol, which you're going to learn about in a minute. And then finally, we have that most evidence-based therapies have been tested on non-chronic and non-comorbid populations, but that's not who the clinician is seeing. So when they test a therapy, they test it on kind of a pure population. So if it's a treatment for anxiety, they rightfully so find clients that just have an anxiety disorder and test it on the people that have an anxiety disorder. But in the community, remember, 1 out of 10 people have a personality disorder. So the people that walk into the therapist's office are not typically coming in with a simple anxiety disorder. It's much more complex than that. And we need a treatment that recognizes that. So the rates of comorbidity, of how many people have multiple disorders, are really high. So for example, people that have depression, 45% also have a personality disorder. Anxiety, 51% have depression and anxiety. Eating disorder, 65% anxiety and an eating disorder, and 52% have an eating disorder and a personality disorder. So it's overlapping. Our diagnostic system doesn't distinguish clearly between these are the symptoms the person has, this is the treatment, and it all fits the diagnosis. So there's been a lot of research on what do we do? And Carla Sharp, whom you may know, has done a lot of work in this area, and other clinicians have too. What's underlying the diagnosis? What's the core problem? What can we treat that and target that's really going to make a difference for the people that we're seeing? And this is where the idea of control, lack of control, and over control came in. In mental health, for many years, we looked at individuals that came in for therapy as having a lack of self-control. And that the whole idea for psychological health was to help them develop better control. So there, it was a line like this, a trajectory, that the more self-control you had, the better. You weren't impulsive. You weren't impulsive if you had self-control. If you came in and you were impulsive, we want to teach you self-control. If you can't control your emotions, we want to teach you how to regulate your emotions. We want to teach you self-control. And that would lead to psychological well-being. So that was the model that we looked at for a long time. But what if it's not that way at all? What if you can have too much of a good thing? What if it doesn't just go on forever, that trajectory, the more self-control, the better? What if there's this bell curve and there's an optimal level of self-control? So here's psychological well-being and here's self-control. Right here in under control is where we have people that have borderline personality disorder, the impulsivity, the difficulty regulating their emotions. That's under control. The core underlying target, if you would, is under control. But there's a group of people over here, and these people have too much control. And if you have a group of people that has too much self-control, that it's getting in their way, they're perfectionistic, they are inhibiting their emotions, they've got a lot of rigid and rule-governed behavior that they go by those rules, they aren't impulsive at all, they're overly planned, they have a rigid schedule. We're going to talk some more about some of those characteristics. You don't want to teach those people more self-control. But yeah, that's kind of what we were doing. We're having people with anxiety disorders with an underlying over-control, a need to be in control, and we were teaching them more control, how to regulate by having more control. Maybe that's not the way to do it. So the Thomas Lynch is looking at, in RODBT, two basic superordinate personality styles. Now, the first thing I want to kind of be clear about is that having a personality is important. You have a personality, I have a personality, and we all tend to be one or the other. We all tend to be a little bit more, we lean toward over control or we lean toward under control. I happen to lean toward over control. There's nothing wrong with that. Having a personality is important, and you have to have a personality style. So the first thing to look at is the personality style. So there are two superordinate personality styles. Now, when those personality styles become a problem and they're getting in the way of the person living the life they want to live and they develop emotional disorders, then we want to look at the type of personality style that's underlying those disorders. So, under control. The under-controlled person is dramatic. Like you give a child when they're, you can see this at like around ages 4 and 5. And if you give a child a cookie, they're going to snatch a cookie up and eat it. They are more likely to get in trouble. Their behavior is based on their emotions. They feel like doing something and they do it. They're impulsive. They're very expressive and they're fun to be around. And they have a lot of caring. And this is where people with borderline personality disorder fall. Overcontrolled, on the other hand, is emotionally constricted, shy, risk averse. They don't want to take any chances. They're socially anxious. And they tend to develop more internalizing disorders. And they tend to become very isolated. As children, they're often the ones that absolutely go by the rules, are so afraid of getting in trouble. And they can be the ones that are really bullied in school. They don't need more control. They need to be able to relax more, to not be so tense and wound up. They need to be more laid back and they need to have more fun. Let's practice that. So I'm going to show you a video. And what I want you to do is see if you can notice some of the characteristics of the person who might be over-controlled. I don't know for sure, but they look like they might be over-controlled, and a person who is more under-controlled. And this is not pathological. This is not a disorder. This is just under-controlled and over-controlled, just to give you a picture of that. So you ready? You might recognize these people. Let's see. You know, watch their faces. Watch for expressions.
A man walks down the street. He says, why am I soft in the middle now? Why am I soft in the middle? The rest of my life is so hard. I need a photo opportunity.
Oh my gosh, he's leaving.
I want a shot of redemption. Don't want to end up a cartoon in a cartoon graveyard. Bone digger, bone digger. Dogs in the moonlight. Far away in my well-lit room. Just a beer, melon, beer, melon. Get these mutts away from me.
Watch his expressiveness. Watch the way he moves his body. Now watch him.
If you be my bodyguard, I can be your long lost pal. I can call you Betty, Betty, when you call me, you can call me out.
There he goes again.
A man walks down the street and says, why am I short of attention? Got a short little span of attention. And all my nights are so long. Where's my wife?
Look at the way his body is. Look at the hand moves.
Who'll be my role
facial
model? Now that my role model is gone. Duck back down the alley with some roly-poly little bat-faced girl. All along, there were incidents and accidents. There were hints and allegations.
Now watch him.
Bodyguard, I can be your long-lost pal.
What's the facial expression?
I can call you Betty, and Betty, when you call me, call me out.
Okay. So did you see the difference? Did you notice how flat one person's face was and how expressive the other person's face was, how big the movements were for one and how contained on the other person? So those are some of the ways that we can notice over control versus under control. And over control people, they're often really miserable inside, but even clinicians are not recognizing it because they're not roaming the streets. They're not talking about the misery. They're not causing riots. They are hyper-focused perfectionists who are, they see mistakes everywhere. They're hard on themselves. They get a lot of harsh judgments about themselves. They can be distress over-tolerant. Instead of teaching distress tolerance, we have to teach don't tolerate so much distress. Have a friend that went to a yoga class in the middle of yoga class and one of the moves broke her nose. You know, she fell on the floor and broke. She finished the yoga class. That's over tolerance of distress. The people who are over controlled contribute to our society so much. If I have surgery, I want someone who's over controlled. I want that perfectionistic person. And they work really hard, often work dedicating themselves to the work they do, and they don't make a big deal out of it. And they often feel really underappreciated. And they really don't show their distress on the outside when they can be miserable on the inside. If you're interested in how this falls out diagnostically, so now we're talking about more of the disorder, that when there is a mental disorder, what disorders tend to be for the person who is over-controlled and what tend to go with the person who's under-controlled. And this is sort of the list of that. As you can see, of course, borderline personality disorder is over here with under-controlled, and over here is the over-controlled with anorexia, treatment-resistant anxiety, obsessive-compulsive personality disorder, which is probably the most prevalent personality disorder that we have, avoidant personality disorder, and chronic treatment-resistant depression is often someone who is over-controlled. So buyer temperament matters. So the under-control person, it comes into this world with a biology that is different than the over-controlled person. And the under-control person has a high reward sensitivity. They can get excited about things. There's a group of people down there. It must be a party. Let's go. They have global focus processing. And this is where that kind of black and white thinking comes in. They sort of see things all black, all white. Don't sort of look at the details. Global focus processing. They have low inhibitory control. That's the impulse control issues where they, if they feel something, you see it. They show it on their face. They show it in their, and they act on it. They act on their emotions. So they have low inhibitory control. Now, both the under-controlled and the over-controlled have high threat sensitivity. And that means that they tend to be hypervigilant for threat. And they see threat where other people wouldn't. And that high threat sensitivity can be, like the example about the group of people, you know, the undercontrolled people see a group of people down at the end of the street, it's a parade. The overcontrolled person, it's a riot. You go into a rose garden and the overcontrolled person sees the thorns. Ooh, they could hurt. And the undercontrolled person says, look at the beautiful flowers. So the high threat sensitivity is, so I'm going to confuse you here and I didn't mean to. But people with borderline personality disorder happen to have a high threat sensitivity too. So in that way, they're more similar to the people who are over-controlled. And that high threat sensitivity goes along with a low inhibitory control. So they feel threatened and they can't control their actions. And so often they're very trying to protect themselves in ways that look to us is very harmful. The over-controlled person has a high threat sensitivity, but they also have a high inhibitory control. So they inhibit all of the emotional expression. And that what they do is put on an armor so that you can't see what they're feeling on the inside. And you can't get an idea of what they're really thinking. You don't, they just look fine. Everything's just fine. But that armor keeps them from getting close to other people. That high detail focused processing, they can pick out the one book in the whole room that is out of alignment. It also means that they can pick out all the things they're doing wrong and be very focused on just minute details. And they have a low reward sensitivity, which means it's kind of hard to motivate them because nothing's really exciting. Nothing is too strong, but few things are really exciting to them except for achievement and productivity. Things that they can say, look what I accomplished. So there are four basic deficits to overcontrolled, and these are the people that are treated with RO-DBT. They lack receptivity and openness. And this means that people who are overcontrolled in a more disordered kind of way, that they avoid feedback. They block feedback. They don't want to see new, they don't want to be in new situations. And the blocking the feedback is a real problem because that's one of the ways in relationships we learn how to get along with people is by feedback from each person. And each person has a different way of relating. So they say, hey, I like it when you do this. I don't like it when you do that. That annoys me. And people who are over-controlled, this perfectionism, they push away the feedback. They have a compulsive need for structure, rigid responding. And so their schedule can be that, so let's say they run every day at 10 o'clock. It's Christmas Day. And they still go running, even though family may be there for just a couple of hours. But they have a compulsive need to keep to their structure, even when it's not conducive to effective relationships. They have a lack of emotional expression and awareness. They can be, it's kind of inhibited expression, as you noticed in the video, kind of an inhibited face. And by the way, guys, if you have a completely flat face like this, how do you think that's interpreted by other people? For many, many reasons, a totally black, flat face is interpreted as anger. And so the person who is overly controlled is sending out a signal of anger when they don't intend to. And this gets in the way of connections. So all of this actually gets in the way of connection. So the person who's over-controlled has a lack of social connectedness and a lack of intimacy. And that leads to emotional loneliness. And what we know now is that there's an epidemic of loneliness all over the world. The Surgeon General has even said, you know, it is an epidemic, the loneliness. And the research is showing that instead of loneliness coming out of depression, but you're depressed, so you get lonely, and it's a side effect of depression, that loneliness is leading to depression and other disorders. This inability to connect, this inability to be part of a community is part of what's happening to the detriment of our emotional health. And that's especially true for people who are over-controlled. So RO DBT looks at it that we're not treating depression, we're not treating anorexia, we're not treating obsessive compulsive personality disorder. It's not the primary problem. What we're treating is disordered overcontrol, maladaptive overcontrol. And that out of maladaptive overcontrol comes a problem with social signaling deficits. Social signaling is any behavior you do in the presence of another person that communicates to that other person. And it can be a monotonic voice. It can be the lack of a smile. It can be words that you use. It can be a flat face, or it can be an overly pro-social smile where you just smile all the time, but it's inauthentic. And in DBT, they talk about inauthentic expression. And where the person who has overcontrol, the inauthentic expression comes about in a different way. It leads to loneliness, as I said, but it's very tricky to treat. Some people, you say, okay, we will introduce you to people. We will put you in a situation where you're around other people and then you won't be lonely. We'll teach you social skills. You won't be lonely. But remember, this is a biology. It starts with biology. And the biology is such that it's an almost automatic response. If you're out running and you see a stick on the ground, but it looks like a snake, your body will react. It will go snake before your brain can even call it a snake. You will jerk back out of fear and then look and say, oh, it's a stick, or I thought it was a snake. But your nervous system is reacting before your brain can label it. And that's what's happening with the personality styles. The overcontrolled is seeing threatened before they even label it. And they are reacting out of that threat because guess what? For the overcontrolled person, being with other people is a threat situation. So they are in threat when they're around other people. And if you're in threat, your social signals are going to be inhibited and you're not going to be able to connect and make friends and be socially adaptive. It also makes them more rigid and less adaptive to change. So RODBT has developed a way of working to help them overcome the biology and to work with their biology so that they can learn. They have to overcome the biology, learn a way to get out of their threat system so that they can learn skills to connect with other people. And then that's the way out of the misery and the depression. So social signaling matters, close social bonds matter, and we're teaching them how to do this. So it's time for another little bit of fun. I'm looking at the clock, seeing how I'm doing. It's time for another little bit of fun, and I'm going to show you a video on social signaling, but it wasn't meant to be a video on social signaling. This gentleman is a comedian in England. And he's going to talk about eyebrows. And it turns out that eyebrows are very important in terms of the way we communicate to other people. So if I keep my eyebrows down or I raise them, it gives a totally different message. Let's listen.
Things I'll be talking about tonight will involve having my eyebrows up. It's not to say that I don't put them down from time to time. Most of the time. Yeah, probably shouldn't have mentioned it at the start, because what happens is people just end up looking at your eyebrows and listen to what you're saying. Watching these two little bits of fur move up and down. But it is important to know where your eyebrows are when you're talking. Always have your eyebrows up when you're asking someone where the toilets are. Do you know where the toilets are? Toilets? Don't be going, do you know where the toilets are? Toilets.
So I think you get the idea about how much actually more important social signaling is than sometimes the words that we say. So here's a more serious view of social signaling. And this is from infancy in terms of the social signaling between the parent and child. Now this work was done around attachment, but social signaling is like the language of attachment, and it impacts even the parent and the infant interaction.
Babies this young are extremely responsive to the emotions and the reactivity and the social interaction that they get from the world around them. This is something that we started studying 30, 40 years ago, when people didn't think that infants could engage in social interaction. In this still phase experiment, what the mother did was she sits down and she's playing with her baby who's about a year of age.
I'm like, girl.
Oh, and she gives a greeting to the baby. The baby gives a greeting back to her. This baby starts pointing at different places in the world, and the mother's trying to engage her and play with her. They're working to coordinate their emotions and their intentions, what they want to do in the world. And that's really what the baby is used to. And then we ask the mother to not respond to the baby. The baby very quickly picks up on this. And then she uses all of her abilities to try and get the mother back. She smiles at the mother. She points because she's used to the mother looking where she points. Yeah. The baby puts both hands up in front of her and says, "What's happening here?" She makes that screechy sound at the mother, like, come on, why aren't we doing this? Even in this 2 minutes, when they don't get the normal reaction, they react with negative emotions, they turn away, they feel the stress of it, they actually may lose control of their posture because of the stress that they're experiencing.
It's almost painful to watch. So in DBT and in family connections, you're used to the transactional model. And the transactional model there is about the way that you respond to the dysregulation of a loved one, or the way that they respond to you, and how that impacts each other. And this is the same, but it's not about dysregulation. It's a transactional model based on the inhibition of emotional expression. And what the mom did was inhibit her emotional expression, and it caused a great deal of distress to the baby. That's a transactional model and interaction. So when someone inhibits their emotional expression, it makes other people really uncomfortable. And that's what happens with the overcontrolled person. They're inhibiting their emotional expression. It may not be as obvious as this. This is really exaggerated, but it still impacts other people, so they don't want to be around. Now, how does that relate to borderline personality disorder? So let me just throw this in. So radically open DBT is not a treatment for borderline personality disorder. But what we're finding is that sometimes for stage two, when someone has learned to regulate their emotions and they are no longer engaging in behaviors of discontrol, then there's still some people with BPD who have trouble connecting with other people. And RO-DBT seems to be an effective treatment, at least in my practice, for people who are working to develop relationships with other people and learning the social communication and how to develop intimacy, because that's really what it's about, how to develop intimacy with other people and feel connected. So that's where I think RO DBT comes in. Another place where I think RO DBT comes in is we are getting better in terms of diagnosis. And at my clinic, we found that we were trying to treat many people with who had over control, and we were trying to treat them with DBT. And sometimes that was family members. So I hope that perhaps I can just bring a little bit of awareness that I love DBT and I'm a very strong DBT advocate. And at the same time, I also think there's another group of people that we now have a treatment that can work for them. I can remember being in Linehan's training and being so excited that I now knew how to help a group of people that I didn't know how to help before. And I felt the same way with RO DBT, that I now knew how to help a group of people that I didn't know how to help before. And they're different groups of people. So I hope, I think this is about 40 minutes. So I'm gonna stop and answer your questions and see if I can clarify anything for you.
Great, thank you so much. And yes, we do have questions. And typically when we move to questions, we see a whole lot more questions come in. So I'm gonna start with the very first question that people started to pose, and it came in multiple times in multiple forms. What if somebody appears to be or is diagnosed with both over control and under control issues? And people pose this in various number of ways, maybe in different aspects of your life. Maybe they swing from one extreme to the other, or you know, the different diagnoses. Like, for example, my child is diagnosed with both BPD on one side and anorexia and OCD on the other side. How does it relate?
Okay, so OCD is, unless it's chronic and treatment resistant, OCD is actually not an overcontrolled diagnosis. Cool. So now let me go to the other. This is a developing science. So we are learning more and more. It doesn't fit the science to be both undercontrolled and overcontrolled. So, but we're just not that good yet at determining which it is. So someone could be anorexic and be undercontrolled. It has to do with having to assess the underlying personality type. So if someone is anorexic and undercontrolled, you could use DBT. If someone's anorexic and overcontrolled, we would want to use RO DBT. Typically, anorexia, because of the perfectionism, the rule-oriented approach, typically it is more of a OC disorder. But it all goes back to assessing the underlying personality type. Now, it gets more confusing. So people who are over-controlled in their family, they can look under-controlled, because especially people with anorexia can rage. They show a lot of emotion in their family. And so as family members, they may look a certain way, but out in the world, they have the perfectionistic mask. They have the inhibited emotion. So they look very different. We call that leakage, that the over-control person has leakage. They control, and then they leak. Or there's leakage in private, but in public, very rarely. Did that help?
I think so. And I'm sure that there's a lot more to it that you could just keep on talking, but yeah, that definitely helped me. And to bring it back to my example, my child's OCD was absolutely responsive to treatment. So, you know, it's not that chronic situation that you mentioned. But somebody else asked, could you define chronicity? What does it really mean when you say a condition is chronic?
A condition is chronic when it doesn't respond to treatment. And okay. It's almost the same as treatment resistant. So they've had the disorder for many years and it's not responsive to treatment, then that would be chronic.
Okay. All right. Thank you. lay people, we don't know all the terms and all the ins and outs. A lot of people are also wondering about the relationship about this concept of over control and whether it has any relationship to learning disabilities or learning differences, people who have ADHD on the Asperger's or autism spectrum, that kind of thing.
The Asperger's and autism spectrum is absolutely over control. Like if you look at the most, the person who has the most over control characteristics is often someone who is autistic, and then someone who is on, who has Asperger's. So it goes from there to anorexia. So yes, it is the a key disorder for over control would be the autism, the person who has autism. Now, what was the other part of that question, Doreen?
ADHD and learning disabilities.
ADHD is more confusing. We don't know yet the answer is. And so it appears that some people with ADHD are over-controlled and some are under-controlled. It's still being researched. We don't have a research answer on that yet. It's still being evaluated and looked at. And learning disabilities, I think learning disabilities, they could be either over-controlled or under-controlled personality style.
Okay. And there's more here because of course, so many comorbidities and yes, people's paths to a diagnosis. CPTSD was another one people are wondering about. And then does this overlap at all with the concept of extroversion versus introversion?
Oh, what a complex question. Okay. So let me do PTSD first. Complex PTSD. So here's the personality structure, right? So the personality structure is over-controlled or under-controlled. This child can be born and have under-controlled or over-controlled personality type. What happens in their life then doesn't change their personality structure. But so either can have trauma. But what we know is that the person who has an over-controlled personality style, the trauma often doesn't respond to what we call first line trauma treatment. So if someone has over control and they have complex trauma, there is a possibility that some of the trauma treatments will not be effective. And if that's the case, then we move to something different. And I'd have to talk about a whole new treatment to talk about that, but in RO, they look at much exposure is typically the treatment for trauma, and it's much shorter exposure because the person has such a high threat sensitivity, and they have such control that it's important to do it a much briefer time. And we're actually seeing really amazing results sometimes with very brief periods of working on the trauma, but that's for an over-control person. So there's that one. Now, introversion and extroversion. Introversion and extroversion are different concepts, but they are related, but they're different concepts. So introversion and extroversion has to do with what the person is kind of comfortable with. I'm an introvert, so I'm much more comfortable being with people for a while and then being by myself to rejuvenate. So, and I'm over-controlled. But introversion and extroversion is more of a choice in some, like I can choose to go be with people. I can choose to be by myself. It's more of a self-efficacy kind of thing. And I can't choose to be over-controlled or under-controlled. I can choose skills, but I can't choose to be over-controlled or under-controlled.
That choice, is that something that sort of evolves out of the social environment that you grow up in?
Which choice are you talking about?
The choice, like where if you're making a choice, if you describe that introversion and extroversion as choice versus the over control and under control is sort of more something that's just a part of who you are as part of your personality structure. So if you're talking about something that is a choice that you're making, are you making that because you've learned to do that?
Yes, maybe you've learned to do that, but the choice that I'm I would still prefer to be with people a short period of time and come home and be by myself. I would prefer that. So the choice is that I can make myself do something different.
Oh, okay.
In terms of the introversion and extroversion. It doesn't change my preference, but I can make myself. And overcontrolled or undercontrolled, I can't make myself be undercontrolled. I can't make myself, okay, I'm just going to be happy, lackadaisical, not care about money and be impulsive, have fun and be laid back and not care about, I can't do that, even if I try really hard to choose it. So it's a difference of self-efficacy. I don't know. It's complicated.
Yeah, I'm getting that. I think everything you're talking about is complicated, actually. And that goes right back to what you said at the very beginning, that, you know, in order to make treatments more effective for more people, they have to be like, they have to really be much more directed and not fine-tuned is not the right word, but more focused, more thoughtful and intentional in terms of what will be effective for each person.
Yes. And it has to be a concept that is underlying. Like it's sort of almost like we've been treating more of a surface issue. And now we're really trying to get what's the core here for this person that we treat that really makes a difference. So RO says we don't treat directly anorexia. We treat the overcontrol that was there from age 4. And if we can get them to be more relaxed, open their brain, accept more feedback, be less rigid, be less perfectionistic, all of which are overcontrol characteristics, then and connect with people, the anorexia is not an issue. And if you focus too much on food, you actually may reinforce that a little bit.
So a lot of it comes down to this idea of making sure that you've assessed the situation and the problems correctly. So what kind of time frame are you looking at with that? And is this something that's different from regular DBT, for example, in that process of assessing, diagnosing, and coming up with your case formulation at the beginning of treatment?
So RO DBT, no, actually it's the structure is pretty similar. You know, like a DBT starts with basically 4 sessions, you know, the first 4 sessions when you do the life worth living goal and you do the assessment about past behaviors that have interfered with therapy and you'd make the agreements and you do an assessment. RO DBT has a first 4 sessions too. And so in those first 4 sessions, you do the assessment. There are checklists to help determine if you're overcontrolled or undercontrolled. There's an assessment interview that they can use to help determine overcontrolled or undercontrolled. And then there are individual sessions. After the first 4 sessions, there are individual sessions, and there is a skills class as well. The skills are just very different in RODBT.
Could you maybe speak to some of the things that are different in RODBT, like what some of those differences might be in the skills? Because I think our audience is probably much more familiar with standard DBT and wondering what the difference might be.
Okay, so in DBT, we have the concept of radical acceptance, which is the ability to accept reality as it is and ease suffering. In RO DBT, we have radical openness. And radical openness is the ability to be, it says we see the world as we are, not as it is. And that's the idea, you know, that the fish that swims in water doesn't know what water is. And so in radically, remember, people who are overcontrolled, they regulate their emotions with no problem. So we lean into emotions in RODBT. So when they are experiencing distress of some kind, we lean in and say, what is that telling you? What is it you can learn from that? What is it that might be different about the world than you thought? And it is a way of starting, it's called self-inquiry. And it is a way to start getting out of sort of rigid thinking, sort of fixed mind thinking, and accepting the emotions and paying attention to them in terms of what you can learn from them. So radical openness is about being open to what you might not know and saying because people who are overcontrolled tend to think they know they're right most of the time. And so this is a way of saying, hey, can you look at the world a little differently? What's happening here? What's this emotion telling you? What can you learn from that? Hmm. Now, for someone who's under control, I'm definitely not going to say lean into your anger. Let's look at your anger. Let's sit with your anger. We're not, we're going to talk about regulating it first, you know?
So. Okay. Great. Thank you. That's really helpful to me. I hope it's helpful to others as well. Can you speak a little bit to what the role of the family is in this? Maybe, you know, is there a role for, like in BPD, we talk about that transactional idea of the social or cultural environment, sort of building on the genetic disposition. And if that's the same for this type of situation, and then maybe over time, is there something families can do that can help in the way that family connections and DBT skills can help families?
Yes. So the family, well, let's just say the environment. So the environment that encourages the development of more over control is one that is focused on achievement, focused on being productive with time, that focus on not that mistakes are shouldn't be made, that, you know, okay, look what you did wrong. How are you going to correct it next time? That are focused on not being vulnerable, never let them see you sweat. So it's kind of and you know, it's the best of intentions again, right? I mean, a lot of this is about building a citizen that is going to contribute to the community, the family, and the world. And it's just that interaction with that temperament that then can make it become too much of I can't make a mistake, too much of I need to achieve, too much of I need to do the right thing. So what the family can do in this is if you have a child who's over controlled, start really paying attention to play and having fun and teasing, and that it's okay to, hey, so you made a mistake? Well, okay, we all make them. And to sort of normalize versus encouraging the perfectionism. So just in a nutshell, those are some things. In RO DBT, we believe in the strength of the family. Like, we want connection, and the place that a lot of people can learn connection is in the family. And so we want to encourage the person who is over control often has difficulty with conflict. So we want to help them learn how to solve problems in the family, to be able to find the voice and speak up in the family, to find you in the family, to learn how to be vulnerable, to in the family, to learn how it's okay to make mistakes. So the family, as you know, I'm working on the book for the families, and it's a really critical arena, but it's from a strength point of view. We want to take the strengths of the family and share them with the person who is struggling with over control.
Fabulous. Thank you. I'm going to turn it over to Kathleen because I'm sure she has some questions as well. And then I can scroll through as well and see what else we have for you in the last few minutes.
Karyn, the first one would be, can you and where would you get an assessment to determine which type of personality you are?
There's an easy assessment that I think is available online. It's just a checklist. And I mean, you're looking at various degrees of reliability, right? But there's a simple checklist. It's a forced choice between are you more rigid or are you more relaxed? And it's just a forced checklist. And I think it's available online.
It's so similar to the DSM-5.
It's not in the DSM-5.
It's similar to that kind of a checklist.
Yes. And it's available in Tom's book.
Okay. And this person needs more information or more clarification on, is leakage considered to be dysregulation? You use the word leakage in your presentation?
No, because the person who has leakage will still not do things that are going to get them arrested, or they don't lose control. They express strong emotion, but they don't lose control. So it's, and if they had to, they could pull it in. So it's that person that has over control can stop themselves. And if I say, hey, use your over control, stop it, they can do it. And that's so different from under control. So the leakage is strong expression of emotion that they typically don't do. And that is, like I said, only usually done in private, but it's not dysregulated because it's a strong emotion versus dysregulation.
Totally controlled. Okay. A lot of the questions I have in the chat were similar to what Doreen was asking you.
I've got a couple more, and then that'll probably take us right to 8 o'clock. So I think maybe one big one that's come up is around the issue of substance use and addictions. A lot of us who have family members with PPD know that someone with that kind of emotion dysregulation turns to substances as a coping mechanism. Does that happen as well with over control?
Yes, it does. But typically they'll use substances that are legal. And typically that use of substances, like even with teenagers, they will use the substance, but they won't get in trouble like the person who's under control will. So they still rein it in. And the person who is over control typically would abuse alcohol or something that is legal and often doesn't do it in ways that get them in trouble, but they still do abuse it.
And is it as likely that it would lead to an actual addiction that then also has to be dealt with?
No? Okay. Not as likely, no.
Okay. All right. So it doesn't become a major sort of confounding problem for the person.
Typically.
In the same way. Okay.
So we're doing a comparison between under control and over control, and it's more likely that the person who is under control would lead to an addiction.
Right. But of course, that doesn't rule out the possibility that it might for some specific individuals.
Exactly. I mean, you know, biology comes into play there. And yes, it does not rule out that possibility. Okay. Thank you for clarifying that.
Yeah. All right. And I think maybe the last question we want to ask is, how can people find out more information about knowing about, you know, how can I find a DBT, an RO DBT therapist, specifically in Canada? I'm not sure how common it is here. Maybe how do they go about finding additional resources on the internet? And if you could maybe give us the details, you mentioned Tom's book, if you could give us the details of that for people to look up.
Okay. So there is a, you know, just as DBT has a list of therapists trained in DBT on radicallyopen.net. There is a list of therapists who are trained, and I know you do have a few in Canada. So that's, I don't know how many, but I know you have a few in Canada. Okay. And the book is just Radically Open Dialectical Behavior Therapy. It is a textbook. I don't know how interesting that would be, but Radically Open DBT Workbook is coming out, which is much more written for the layperson, even though it's for eating disorders. Oh, was there another question I missed in there?
Maybe accessing treatment. If people happen to be really resistant to treatment, or how would you go about finding someone, sort of assessing whether they're a good fit?
So that would probably also be like a Radically Open Dialectical Behavior Therapy trained therapist. And so I would go to radicallyopen.net and look at the therapists where they're that are available.
Great. Awesome. I want to thank you once again. We're exactly on 8 o'clock. I'm really, really sorry to our audience out there. People have clearly been really, really engaged in this. Actually, I want to ask, you said it's a young field. Just how young is this study around RODBT? When did it first come into use?
Well, so Tom Lynch actually started working with Marshall Linehan years and years and years ago. And so it's been 20 years in terms of his developing the research, but only in the past, his book came out in 2019, I think. And so he's been working on it for a very long time. But the training, I was trained in 2015. And so that came out at the same time the field is kind of started looking beyond diagnosis and looking at what are some core underlying factors that we need to consider for treatment? And all of that is fairly recent. I guess the last 8 to 10 years, which is relatively recent in the field. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And if there hasn't, you know, if the training has only become available for a few years, then absolutely there won't be a lot of people out there who have the training and the experience with it either. Okay. Yeah. So that explains why it's such a new topic and all of us are really, really starting to learn about it. So that's great. Thank you so very much for having been here with us today. I want to thank our audience for having been here. Thank you everybody for joining us. I am so sorry. We just cannot possibly get to all of the questions. Just to let you know, there were 500 people on this call. So,
hello everyone.
So, you know, for all of the people who are asking questions, please just know that we did have a lot of questions come in and we tried to hit the ones that would help the most people and answer questions for most of you. Thank you once again. Our presenter tonight has been Dr. Karyn Hall, trainer and therapist in RO DBT, Radically Open Dialectical Behavior Therapy. And this presentation was brought to you by the Sashbear Foundation. So, thank you all. Have a good afternoon, evening, good morning, wherever you are, perhaps in Australia, and I hope to see you again. We will be having another presentation in February with Sherry Van Dyke, and she will be talking about helping youth who self-harm. So that will also be a very interesting one, and we look forward to seeing you again then. Thank you, everybody. Good night.
Thank you.